Floyd Zadkovich, International Commercial Lawyers.
Hello and welcome to Floyd Zadkovich's presentation series. This is actually the first time that I've been making such a presentation, and I'm excited to do so. I hope that you find this to be informative as well, and I look forward to making further presentations, including on the topic that I am covering today, which broadly concerns what is termed disclosure in England or discovery in the U.S. Litigation systems. And more specifically, what I wanted to discuss today was Practice Direction 51U, which has recently, or as of January 2019, been implemented in the English system. And there it has been implemented as a pilot program for use in the business and property courts in connection with most matters. Some exceptions do apply. And upon reading that, I found it very interesting because it brought to light for me some of the similarities as well as distinctions between U.S. discovery and English disclosure. Overall, anyone who has had familiarity with most of the common law legal systems will know that discovery or disclosure is a central part of those systems. My view is that over the years, there has been an increasing trend towards more and more similarities between the two systems, at least between the US and the English system regarding discovery or disclosure. Certainly on the mechanical level, there are some very large differences. In the United States, discovery includes not only the exchange of documents, but also the taking of so-called interrogatories, which are basically written questions requiring sworn responses, as well as, most importantly, the taking of depositions or out-of-court testimony, which can subsequently be used in court. In England, the disclosure system is much more focused on the exchange of documents, and that is what Practice Direction 51U and the pilot program which it establishes are focused on. So I wanted to talk more about that today. To begin though, what is discovery or disclosure with respect to documents? It is the process by which litigants take non-protected, meaning not subject to litigation privilege or attorney-client privilege or so-called work product privilege, documents that have bearing, relevance to the claims and defenses at issue, and they provide them to the other side. That is the overarching broad description of the process, and its mechanics vary greatly. In the English system, traditionally, there has been both a practice of standard disclosure as well as one of specific disclosure. Standard disclosure encompasses those documents which a party has and knows it has, which have bearing or relevance to the claims and defenses and must be disclosed. That's very similar actually to the first step in U.S. federal court litigation, which involves something called initial disclosure, using the same word as in England, whereby a party must produce to the other side without being asked copies of documents which it anticipates relying upon at trial. There's further steps beyond that where more particularized requests are made. The English system beyond standard disclosure then moves on to the specific disclosure process, which is analogous to U.S. discovery, whereby written requests for documents are made and then those documents are produced subject to any objections. And that's really where the crux of a problem has developed over the decades. During that specific discovery or specific disclosure process, there is an inherent trend for litigants to believe that their other adversaries are withholding documents, or conversely, that the other side in a suit is using the disclosure process and the burdensomeness that comes along with it to drive up the costs of litigation. It probably goes on, and it can be extremely burdensome. And discovery or disclosure is most certainly one of the costliest phases of litigation. So that brings us to practice direction 51U, which has made a large step forward to trying a new pilot program on how to fix some of those programs. Under practice direction 51U, gone is the distinction between standard disclosure and specific disclosure. And what comes in their place is the concept of initial disclosure, the same phrase used in the US practice, and extended disclosure. At the initial disclosure phase, a party has the obligation to produce all documents which it relied upon in connection with preparing its statement of claim, as well as documents which are necessary for the adverse party to understand the claim. And there is also a concurrent obligation to produce so-called known adverse documents, meaning documents which a party knows that it has, which are adverse to its position in the litigation. All three of those categories of documents must be produced during the initial disclosure phase under the pilot program. Discovery beyond that, in the so-called extended disclosure phase, is by court order only. And with that, there should be, I would think, a substantial step forward in controlling the costs, which often go along with the disclosure process, as well as some of the mutual mistrust that develops between parties. And with that said, I think one of the most interesting considerations in terms of similarities between the US system and the English approach to discovery or disclosure, respectively, is the ever-growing concept of proportionality. Proportionality first came into play in the English system with the reforms of 1999, the so-called Wolf reforms. And those reforms were focused on encouraging the fair and just conduct of litigation, and going hand in hand with achieving that objective was the idea of attempting to place parties on equal footing and ensuring that they would conduct discovery or disclosure with respect for proportionality, that word again. And that same word has purportedly, and I emphasize purportedly, been significant to U.S. discovery for decades. However, in 2015, the U.S. Supreme Court saw it necessary to amend some of the federal rules of civil procedure, specifically a Federal Rule 26, to reemphasize and refocus the role and significance of proportionality in the discovery process. And so in both systems, you have a renewed, reemphasized focus on proportionality. What is proportionality? It's taking a look at the issues at stake, the significance of the claim, be it a monetary quantum or other issue, the consideration of who has better access to materials. There's a whole slew of factors that go into it, but these are considerations that in the first instance, parties should and must consider when they seek discovery, and in the event that there is a dispute over what is or is not disclosable, then these are considerations focused on proportionality, which a court will take account of. Overall, though, my take is that practice direction 51U is a very interesting step forward in emphasizing and implementing that overarching consideration of proportionality, and I will be very interested to see how it develops in the 2 years to come. Thank you.